叫我们来的。
哦，也可以。
There's a fair amount of intelligence in the way of this small computer.
organize these elemental gestures into complex MIDI data streams, which will embed to a synthesizer or sound engineer for a computer. This thing starts life in complete silence. He's if I tell P1 to transmit a particular MIDI channel number, and tell it to transmit a particular note, and none of the other keys do anything. Produces some music, play it on key. So we go on with that, and rather than spend another hour programming keys, we're going to call up a higher definition. Now we have, I think, a whole bunch of keys right there.
The idea behind change of the direction of leaves.
Is there a
visual or
a... I wanted a tactile controller, and I started the design by taking a piece of paper and putting my hands on the tab and tracing the fingers. And so the that's what came out. There's a little... I studied redundancy for a little while. It's happened in the development. Intrigued by the possibility of just using a static hand position and sensing the gestures and sort of the and then there's quite a few designs, but this turned out to be quite interesting. Turns out it's a natural extension of the hand. And I like accents too, so there's some real nice. A lot of instrument designs are based on, you know, they're famous things that you're familiar with. It's like a William Alton pad, which is a square array. And it's, I don't think it's just written for the human physiology. It's just kind of amazing. Great questions.
What's the sensor technology?
We're using a sealed membrane and sensing the displacement. Most membranes are turned into switches in which it sets contact, which means that they're not very sensitive. This thing responds to everything. Fast enough to respond to something that has to do with some very sophisticated.
sound good in 15 milliseconds?
Actually, every 2 milliseconds.
Times for each one.
Yes, that's right. 500 times 10 to 12 meters per second.
How does this react to a high repetition rate when you hit the key?
React to, I'm sorry, what?
To a high repetition rate.
Oh, the limitation is actually not here. It's in the transmission over this thing here, which is a MIDI cable. And this is limited to only one transaction per millisecond, essentially. So that even piano players observe the problem of playing 10 keys at once with 10 fingers takes 10 milliseconds, which is a certain delay. And then if you add to that the gestures of after the touch, location, velocity, so I transmit them all from here, and you can have problems. The part of the game is to try to filter out the insignificant information not transmitted, which you do here. Try to say, well, that's too small a change to bother transmitting to that channel. So, that a little bit there. And then we have I confess that we have an alternate standard built in here. We have to start somewhere with alternatives. So we transmit another standard that's much faster, but we don't have anything to receive it yet. That standard is called WIM. And that's an acronym for Wideband Interface for Musical Performance. It's there's a MIDI through port here, which can be switched over internally to a WIM out port. You probably think I'm good.
The clock is just a little bit.
What's that? Well, there's a little card. It's a data card on the box. But it's plugs in here to store the setups. Rapidly get to different kinds of settings.
You might be in the market. It's going to be on the market?
Oh, it's on the market now. Yeah. In fact, believe it or not, it's been going. Further questions?
In 1978, when I actually did the piece,
and 18th, and I wrote about it. And then I was invited to ILCAM in Paris in 81 to install the programs that I had written in the old language Fortran. At that time, Pascal, which I normally use now, was hardly on the market, and it came out around 77. And so I was invited to ILCAM in Paris, and their equipment was unfortunately still too slow, still too heavy. And after spending a very, very pleasant 7 months in that city, I returned to Cologne not having achieved anything. And bought a computer at my own expense, which cost about, the equivalent of about 20 of these. And doesn't do much more, that's about the same amount of things, but a couple of years before the Atari came on the market. And was able finally to actually realize that program, and I did so in this very building in 1986. Shortly before the Cthulhu gone to The Hague, where Goldberg invited me to perform, to realize the goal of new piece and performance. And so I had the opportunity finally using small equipment, which was relatively portable, weighed about 25 kilos and broke my back every time, to actually develop a program on a computer I could take to various places. And I did travel with that program and performed in places like Finland. But I couldn't go further than that because I never ever dreamed of putting it into a packing case and putting the whole computer into an airplane. A friend of mine had a similar computer which was thrown from somewhere in Korea. And now I'm not a hardware man at all, and I've completely lost it. Some boards fell off the computer and I wasn't aware to put them back into it. So I was happy to just put the computer myself on the back seat of the car and drive anywhere within a reasonable distance. And then, of course, the Atari came on the market. And it took me about 2 years to finally get the plunge of trying to transfer my program to the Atari. And I'm very skeptical at the beginning, as I said, because the plastic machine won't manage it. And I'm very amazed that it actually did. It's not quite as fast as my own very expensive machine. It's a little bit slower, but it manages practically most of it, about 90-95%, I would say. And so in 1987, I actually transferred that program to the Atari, and every now and then I've been developing it a little bit further. And the most recent development was finished at about 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, no, 5 o'clock this afternoon. And we had to start over here. All of us in a program which composes music in real time. By the way, all of us, you may have guessed, because in honor of my own piece, all of us, Joe Lotus. At the same time, you know what busking means. Standing on the street somewhere and playing music and hoping that people would like it. And this is a kind of automatic reading out of music like that. Just as a person stands on the street and reels out so many hours together rather than piece after piece, and he reels out music in time. So this way, the machine just reels out music. And it's, of course, automatic, so that explains the title too. It requires a number of information like scales. It wants to know whether I want to play in major scale or minor scale or any other scale that I want to define myself. At the moment it's based on a 12-tone system, but there's no problem in thinking of other tunings as well. If you have a synthesizer which can be retuned, so you can fool the computer into thinking the synthesizer is a 12-tone instrument, but retune the instrument to the tuning you want, and the computer has the priorities for this other tuning that you have developed. At the moment, I'm working on a 17-tone tempo tuning for a piece that I was asked for mechanical and for a regular piano. And so what I'm going to do is, when I've got this piece working on a 17-tone scale, it will think that it's really a 17 semitone scale, which repeats at that length, and that's what this program can do. I can create a scale at an interval of, say, a minus six, and then copy the minus six, so that the scale will be built on. The octave doesn't have to be the corner, the edge of the interval, which is repeated. So I can take 17 notes, semitone scale, but I've evaluated the individual notes according to a real 17-tone tempo scale. So the note, which is almost a pure perfect fifth, will be a strong note. That's also part of my mathematical system. I put in simply a scale with no indication of how important the notes are, like a major scale. Who knows, looking at a keyboard, that seven semitones has to be a good interval. It's a matter of rationalization. A frequency enters the brain, which is then compared to the other frequencies, tonic and dominant, and the brain then assumes that the sensible or accepts that the sensible is a very strong and so on. So I worked out a mathematical background of this kind of thing, also for rhythms and meters, and worked out how, given any neutral scale, neutrally defined scale and neutrally defined meter, to work out quality out of this quantity, and then to work on the basis of that. So if I input a major scale in this program, it comes out with pure tuning that is normally, that was in any case on Vogue before 1600, and which is in any case understood today when you play a regular piano. If you were to think of the notes on the piano the way they are really tuned, you'd be amazed how distant the intervals must be. But our ear is able to correct, and this is what I do here too. I input a regular scale, it's corrected by the program to conform to what we probably think and works on that basis. And what comes out is a regular scale, I don't retune it, but it comes out assessed in that manner. Apart from scales and meters, it also needs various types of information like degree of metric clarity, how clear the meter is. Is it ametric or metric or anything in between? I have a scale of 0 to 24 arbitrarily. 24 means very straight meter, 0 means very simple pitch. I have other parameters like event density. This means how often do things happen in a second or in a given unit of time. Or, for example, melodic scope. How far is the melody allowed to jump around? Is it a very smooth melody? Or does it stick on one note only? Or does it jump all over the range? The tonic. The tonic is unique. There's one note in the whole field which is the tonic of all the notes. So that I don't use octave copying the tonics. It's just one note and all the other notes obey that note of the tonic. And this note could be anywhere in the range, but preferably I found the tonic should be rather low down. Then there is chordal density, where there each stream, and there are three streams that it's got to be seen. Each stream, or voice, can contain up to three notes at a time. But within a stream, there is no overlapping of time. Then there is tonality index, this is one of the most interesting ones. Ranging from 0 to 12, 0 meaning atonal music, 12 meaning tonal. Pitch window, the height of the window is given by its middle, and the width of the window. That's where all music happens. The tone could be outside of it too. And dynamics and so on. And I haven't mentioned all the parameters that there are. There are 11 so-called parameters, and then there are little information like what MIDI channel, for those of you who know what that is, the each stream decides to go out on. So I have three computers here. The reason for that is because this program can run in parallel. If I want 9 channels, 9 voices at the same time, I can put 3 computers on, line them up to 9 MIDI channels, and have them all linked up nicely so that they go in sync, they're synchronized. Now, the reason for that is because the computer has such a lot of work to do to work with all these pitches that it's supposed to be playing in real time, supposed to be composing and playing on the spot. And I don't do any composing in advance. Every of this composing is done exactly from the millisecond on that the event is desired. And it happens in a very few milliseconds, like 20 milliseconds at most, hopefully. So that it's not really in my interest to write a program which tries to strain the processor to such an extent that it wants to do like 8 channels or even more. 3 is hard enough, and maybe when the Atari, the next model comes out, or another computer, and I've mentioned the language already, which would be even faster, then the same program could go much faster. One could link several of them together. The Atari are not that extensive. So I think it's much better to work modularly. But what I'm going to demonstrate for the first time today, and hope it works, is not the use of the computers in parallel, although those two are in parallel, but the use of computers in series. This is a box here. Outputs similar information, MIDI information. This is made by J.L. Cooper in California. And Stein is working on a failure system for myself, which is more elaborate than this, which also not only outputs values through failures, but reads in values and can display them
on a light strip. And the idea is that the autobus can accept controls from outside. These figures you see here, I can change in various ways. The figures on the screen are the values for the various parameters. I can change them with the mouse, move the mouse to the point, and left or right button raises or lowers the value. I can use the keys here, and every number on the top row gives me a parameter number, and I follow it for the keys that over for the three streams. Another reason for keeping the program to only three streams, but there are only three rows of letter keys. And if I press a key, and with or without shift, the value corresponding to that stream, to that parameter, that's a real matrix, is then changed, increased or decreased. That's the second way of changing the values. The third way is on disk. I can store the value on disk with a time tag, and the computer keeps looking at its clock, and when the time is due, it then executes a certain parameter, brings in the value and changes it. That's the third way. The fourth way is using this fader box. I must say, this has worked since about 12 o'clock today. And so I can move these faders, and these 8 correspond to the first 8 parameters, starting with center clarity, going down to tonality index. And if I press the button, then the next 8, which means actually these 3, are then accessible. So this is MIDI. The output of this box is MIDI, just as the output of the computer is, which goes to the synthesizer. So it's interesting to me to use the output of the program autobus to control itself, as if it were a fader box. And this is interesting for the following reason. If I say, use tonality 8, or whatever, or use keynote C in the octave 4, then the music remains in key of C for ages. And it's all very nice at the beginning of the Rheingold or the Indian music. But after a while, you may feel the desire to go to G. And since sometimes the program does actually compose bass lines, which sound like that. Pom, 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 pom. And, you know, reminds very much of double bass player or somebody else playing bass instrument. I decided to rechannel that information back into the computer. It couldn't be rechanneled into itself, but I prefer to do it here on two others. Let's say on this one. You can see it's the same program, at least it looks like it. So what's going to happen here, if all goes well, if there is a lot of computers and what's going to happen is, I'm going to be more or less at this end. This computer is composing music which is very silly. It is not music. It's controls for that computer. If you hear what comes out of this, it would be terrible. So this goes into that, causing very few parameters to change. I cause the key. You may notice from after maybe the middle of the audience, this row over here, I move the mouse around so you can see where I'm at. This is the row, which is parameter 6. It's a keynote. It'll change that in all three. It'll change the dynamics of the middle channel, over here, the little stream or voice. And it'll also change the event density of the third. So you see, it can be very selective. One of the channels is going to be doing all the work changing the event density of the third stream. One of the channels will change the keynote of all three streams. And one channel will change the dynamic of this one screen. On that computer, we have another score, a real score which runs in time, which has been read, which will be read from disk. And those two will be running more or less in parallel. I say more or less because actually, until I changed the program the last few days, it was possible very easily to have one program start the other, one computer start the other, rather revamp everything. So I thought rather than take valuable time to try and make that work again, I'll try and start both synchronously by hand. I hope they don't get up of sync. I won't test you if you go on for too long anyway. Right, so you have two computers controlling music, I mean 6 channels of music, and this computer talking to that one, and me over here using these faders occasionally and using the mouse on all three boxes. So let's see. All is all up. Okay. front of this used system. And, right, it's not the same. Any questions? And answer any you have any.
So that the learners test the command of the Z one and the I got from there, or is it so?
No, they're all different. I mean, this is the one, actually, in that one made the percussion noise, and I didn't bother to change that very much. That ran on its own, and I had a score restored on this. So this kept getting gradually changed very gradually. This one made the pitch noises, and it was the left screen that was mainly coming out from there, I don't know. So it's because the parameter pitch focus stays very low. But then later I expanded the scope of that particular parameter, that particular voice, and it began to suddenly go all over this. So I can change my window, but anyway, any one of the screen layers could be low or high. In the Beethoven variations that time, I had very clear subdivisions and the voice remained in their various pitches for a long time. Right, so is there any more questions about this particular program? So I'd like to go on to talk about what we're going to hear after the interval. My piece for orchestra. I'd rather get the talking over with now, and we come back fresh off the pause and be able to listen to it. That's a piece of, I would like to say, real music. It's a bit unusual these days to talk about equipment, to talk about a piece of orchestra, in which I'm not trying to make something work, I'm not trying to put cables together and hope that they will work, and hope that the right signal get across the right time and reach the right address. But that you have a tape which musicians have played on stage, the piece has been really written out note for note, albeit using a computer program, and really rehearsed and really played. Real music, in other words. Something that you can be pretty sure of. And none of all this experimental business, where you always just where the composer, the musician, is really a technician, always hanging around, but not with a soldering iron, at least with some sort of hardware in his pocket. The piece Orchidea Ordinaria, or the 12th Root of Truth, has several reasons for its title. It's one thing. Orchidea Ordinaria, meaning common orchids, it's not very botanical, and the allusion to the botany is, of course, intended, is a very organic piece, and that's one of the reasons why it's a botanical title. Another reason is, it's an example of ordinary, of ordered, of orderly, well-behaved orchids. In other words, order meaning with the use of very heavy structures, orderly, very well-behaved, not trying to disturb society in its convenience and comfort, and also ordinary. And orchids is another kind of semi-acronym for orchestral ideas. And the 12th root of truth, of course, those of you who work with the mathematical notes that's based on the semitone, that's the 12th root of 2. But I also want to allude to the fact that truth is not, in my view, something which is tangible and which is even relevant to existence or being. A lot of society bases its views and its actions on what it's often defined as truth. There are several books written on what truth is, and several people are occupied being highly paid, such as Italy, for example, to propagate to the world what truth is. And I know less and less what truth is, and I'm actually quite happy to have found that I didn't mean the topic at all. I mean, truth is just if you want to agree with somebody else, as well, you saw a man we went over by a town the other day, and in this case I saw him. We say that's so true, and then that's true because you have actually seen it. That's as far as I think that the idea of truth really needs to go. This piece, I've already alluded or hinted that it's a little bit about comfort and convenience. It's actually about the convenience of convention. It's all very nice to be as conventional as possible because if you are, you're rewarded for this by society. You're also, it might be less, You don't have to go too far away from the, in fact, it's a little bit this and that, and try to keep within that which your public can be educated to want, and you'll be very well taken care of. And even new music, which used to be at one time the ghetto almost of people who really believed in truth and who wanted to do their own thing and not care about whether it was acceptable or accepted to other people or by other people. Even in this field, we now find traces of Michael Jackson's syndromes. You find composers of new music running after producers with heavy scores under their arm saying, oh, please do with this piece, I think you'd like it. And, or you find, for example, composers trying to get heavy positions from this and there, here and there, trying to satisfy certain ideas in those of that producer likes this kind of music, so let's try and make it fit in that direction and he'll be happy. And just don't do your own thing, just don't break away from or have any courage whatsoever to be different or to do your own thing, but just try to follow the trends so that you'll have taken care of. After all, you've got to pay for the Atari report if you happen to be a producer. So, this particular piece, I won't say much more about that, but you probably noticed what I'm hinting about. It's in seven movements. The first four form a kind of suite. You might actually think the whole piece is about 37 minutes long. It's quite a massive piece for orchestra, a very large orchestra, called 90 musicians. It was played by the Southwest Radio Orchestra in Baden-Baden. The orchestra sits in Baden-Baden, the concert was in donation in last October. And, right, so it's quite a massive piece. It's in seven movements. First, we might think of it as four movements of a suite, followed by three articles. And the four movements are very classical. They form a kind of introduction. You try to remember these four keywords. Introduction, that's the first, in a very passacaglia type style, gradually getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And the music actually moves through the orchestra. I wrote the score to a using a computer and mapped the entire orchestra on the screen, moved around through the mouse, and kept track of where I was, gradually increasing the window of action. So gradually the whole orchestra set the reverse of Haydn Servos in place. Gradually comes in, but it moves. The parts move without any musician having to get up. The second part is called Pierigo. First part is called Choral. Choral, which is a kind of introduction. The second part is called Pierigo. And that is a very short, about 2.5 minutes, type scherzo, you might say. And second, you will notice traces of music of a very wonderful composer, Igor Stravinsky. And this movement is not only in honor of champagne and pate, but also in honor of Pierre Igor. The third movement is called Hornpipe, and it's not a Scottish or a nautical dance of any nature. It's just a lot of horns and pipes in it. And it's very, very slow and very, it's kind of a slow movement with heavy bass marimbas lumbering along. I've covered the entire surface with rubber sheets. It sounds like walking in the mud a bit. And the fourth movement is called Exequor, which means I will execute. It sounds liturgical, it's like Confiteor. And it is, in a sense, liturgical. It is I will carry out to the bitter end. It's an execution, in a sense. And it's a rondo finale. It goes around in circles and circles and circles and circles. And one of the great minimalist composers, even though it's going to talk about circles, minimalism comes to mind. Anton Bruckner is a visitor in that movement. So repeat the four titles again. Choral, Operal, Perigord, Hornpipe, Exequor. And they have formed an introduction, a scherzo, a slow movement, and a rondo finale. Rondo. And finale, very final sounding piece. It gradually destroys itself as it shows in the story. You gradually find less and less and less and less of your playing. Big gaps appear and you just stop playing for 2 hours and start playing again. And gradually, big holes, the whole orchestra just fritters itself away. But the afterthoughts somewhere in the middle of hornpipe, the third movement, you begin to hear long notes played on string instruments. Not much, very unproven. But gradually these get more and more and more prominent, until at the end of XFO, when the suite is over, you have this very cloying, very sticky, treacly type of music, and it's very nice. And it gets even nicer. And gets to the fifth bar, Orchidea, Orchid. I wrote a piece for piano, especially for the way. I called it L'Orchidée d'Argent, sans colombe. It's something you'd want to play on the piano and have people listening to it. And it's very sweet music. And it's called either L'Orchidée d'Argent, meaning the silver orchid, which is kind of orchid in the moonlight and whatever. It also means the orchid of money, if you like. And after L'Orchidée d'Argent, which in this piece, which was then orchestrated by me, so it's not played by piano, but I have a piano version. And if there were a piano here, I would love to sit down and play it again. Very much like, a bit like Tidalman, actually. The sixth movement is very short. It's called Scorpio. It's a constellation of strange things which keep appearing every now and then in the piece. There are strange apparitions. Right through the entire piece, right through chorale, through perigord, hornpipe, and exequor, you reach here strange little things which don't seem to fit into the structure. And they actually come regular intervals at different lengths. And in Scorpio, within the last half a minute, all these come together at one time, causing a great amount of perplexity, you might say, and causes an impasse, because the music is no longer in a position to carry on in this wonderful way of orchidea, orchid. So that's followed by the very last movement, a piece for piano called Pandora. Pandora was the first example of the flying autobus, which is what I demonstrated to you in the previous premiere here in this experimental shape. It was the first time that I linked two computers with autobus and had one controlling the other and output that entire thing as a tennis score. And that was merged there against and saved. The orchestra makes a very short comeback, thinking this piano piece is a tango. And so tries to get into the mood, and for about 1 minute, there's a bit of a tango that happens, and then the orchestra decides to finally give up. And then there are about 10 minutes after that, but there's simply no orchestra. It's entirely piano solo, and that's how the piece ends. So the last three movements, Orchidea, the very sweet orchid, which is really, isn't that all of all this dream of hitting it in Hollywood, you know, making it exciting and rich, trying to make music such a way that millions would love it. And followed by a bit of non-justice, finally with Pandora coming in as a piano piece. Now Pandora is the closest to the music that I wrote earlier, the closest to the music I've been known for. I've been given a certain defense stamp to people say, oh, that sounds like a typical Barber. And when I finished my piece, so we all insisted we know people loved it. And we bought a record and all kinds of nice things, and they asked me to write a piece for conference and Hague. And I wrote other pieces which were similar, because I was interested in that particular thing. But I noticed that the further I moved away from the good old orchestras, the less and less content, the less and less clear people were about, and the more discontent they got. I wrote a piece called Ruiti d'Amore for the cellist Francis Maria Ruiti, which consists of one series of protests. A very bitter piece, there's hardly any music in it. And I've given an idea of this tenor by giving them the title of the first movement. It's called Conforto al Giordano. And those of you who know the fate of Giordano Bruno will appreciate that very delicate culinary experience. Giordano Bruno was burnt at the stake by the church for his beliefs, whereas Galileo retracted all his beliefs and was allowed to live. Giordano Bruno was not. So this piece is very nasty, and nobody liked it. And this piece too, Orchidea Ordinaria, had a lot of people puzzled who don't see their Barlow in this piece. So in order to make them happy, I've given them a little Barlow at the end. Here, have some Barlow. Right, on that note, I would like to say that I have an influence with you in the front. And not really just going to do it.